Let me introduce myself. I'm Tamara Thompson. I'm with Mockingbird Education. I'm the only one from my team here today, similar to what World Ed and KYSU shared. We've just, been incredibly overwhelmed working in response to the pandemic. I want to thank World Ed for inviting us here today. And I also want to say hello to the KYSU team. We've worked with them in the past and excited to see you still doing this work and doing it at such a great level. So thanks for having us. Hello to KYSU. Hello to everyone else. If you're not familiar with Mockingbird Education, I'll give you an introduction to us shortly. But today, let me just clarify what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about synchronous learning. And synchronous learning means at the same time, which basically is any live online interaction, such as a webinar or a Zoom. So today I want to share with you engagement strategies for how we can deliver more effective instruction when we're in those types of environments. So to begin with, let's get organized really quickly. What we do is interactive, so a couple of things that we'll need. We'll be using that chat box, which we just used. If you have your phone handy, we'll be using that a little while later. This is multi-sensory, which means grab you a blank piece of paper if you have one close, a pen. We're going to be interacting quite a bit. Now, I will start with three questions, and let me start with the first question. You'll answer this question in your chat box. What percentage of your online teaching is facilitating live instruction? You have three choices there, A, B, or C. Less than 30% is A, between 30 and 50 is B. If you will type your response in the chat box, that just gives me an idea of where different people are at. Okay, thank you. So we have quite a few people who are spending between 30% and 50%. And if you're not teaching, that's okay. I'll take good care of you in your role there. So here's the second question. Second question is, if you had 10 students, regardless of those students, whether they're at risk or other teachers, in your online webinar, how many of those students will struggle with attention or engagement at some time during your session? Now, I know you may not be completely privy to that, but give me an idea of what you think that is as a facilitator. And thank you for your honesty, I appreciate that. Excellent. And then let me add this to that, just to give you some perspective. 20% of students have attention challenges, which means this, that's 1 in 5. And that is whether it's adult learners or professionals like you and I, or adult basic education learners. And then let me mention that 25% of offenders meet the criteria for attention deficit. And I'm just mentioning offenders because I know that we have some corrections folks on the line and we work really in depth with those types of populations. It's important to mention those last two bullet points, and I'll read them to you, which is this. Students who are least prepared for education are the ones that fare worst in online classrooms, which is, for most of us, those at-risk learners that we're working with. And then that second point is online classrooms are associated with higher dropout rates and lower grades than when the same classes are offered in person. Now, you and I didn't create that reality, but we do have to teach in it. It's important to understand those factors when we look at engagement and we look at learning. Now, one more question, and then I want to share some information with you. How confident are you in your facilitation skills for keeping learners engaged in a live learning session? You have three options there, and I'll give you a moment to read those. And if you don't mind just responding in your chat box. BCA, thank you. Thank you for your response. Excellent. So my goal today is to help add to that toolbox that you have. In that spirit right there of sandbox, I hope you won't mind me having my guide here along the side. That just helps me keep up with our pace and our agenda. So let me share with you really quickly what my goal is. My goal today is to introduce you to strategies that I hope will increase that toolbox to you. For you. And then two, to provide you the science and the research behind why those strategies are effective. And then finally, my goal is to model and demonstrate everything that I teach. I'm not going to do a session on engagement and then not model what engagement looks like in the online environment. Now, I'd like to share just a short video and introduction to you to Mockingbird Education, because before I share these strategies with you and the cognition behind them, I want to share the perspective of how Mockingbird approaches this work. This will give you some context for where these strategies come from and how we look at engagement in an online context. Go ahead in your chat box, give me an R for ready. That just tells me that we still are connected and that we're good.
Mockingbird Education studies the cognitive process of learning.
Now, pause for just a second. Can you hear the audio? Give me a Y or an N. Yes. Okay. Excellent. Here we go.
And how at-risk factors like attention challenges, language difficulties, academic gaps, self-helplessness, and low academic self-esteem impact the learning process. At its core, an educator's struggle with teaching at-risk learners is really a struggle of engagement. How do we keep at-risk learners psychologically, emotionally, and cognitively engaged? There's 70 years of research, 70 years, that indicate that at-risk factors have a negative impact on the learning process. How do we improve student learning experiences for at-risk learners that help our learners overcome these challenges and find learning success? As educators, we have to understand learner engagement. We have to understand the active process of learning. Learning is a biological, psychological, and social process. Learning is impacted by our biological processes of memory formation. Changes in attention, working memory, and long-term memory storage are real, and they play a significant role in learner comprehension. Learning is a psychological process. Lack of confidence, a little I learner mindset, psychologically impacts learning success and our ability to process and comprehend new information during learning. And finally, learning is a sociological process influenced by the relationships that we build with our peers, our teachers, and our learning community. These factors interact together and often have a cumulative impact on learning. How many of our learners lack not only the academic skills, but the confidence, the motivation, and the self-regulation skills to eagerly engage in learning? How many of our learners, even when they have these skills, resist participating and are reluctant to engage in class because of the cultural and social dynamics that influence them? Mockingbird Education is on a mission to improve learning experiences for at-risk students and to provide practical teaching solutions to help educators engage at-risk learners in their classroom. With the help of talented educators, over the course of 20 years, Mockingbird has organized solutions into an instructional approach that help educators understand how to integrate bio, psycho, and social teaching strategies into one interactive and holistic approach. We model what we teach, we approach our work with passion, and we pour that passion into training teachers and developing curriculum. We're excited you're joining us today, and we look forward to learning with you. If you're interested in our curriculum, our workshops, or our mission, reach us at our website at www.mockingbirdeducation.com.
Now, I share that video with you just to give you the context of how Mockingbird approaches the work and approaches the strategies that I'm going to share with you. Learning is a biopsychosocial process, and it doesn't matter to us if we're looking at in-person instruction or we're looking at online instruction. We have to take those factors into account. Now, before we do a breakout session when we're going to look at strategies in more detail, I really want to start with some information that will be useful to everyone regardless of what role you play in a classroom, whether you're an administrator or a classroom teacher or a facilitator who just facilitates learning sessions online. I want to share with you three really critical elements of learning related to engagement and attention that I think are important no matter what you do. And by what you do, I mean whether you're giving a talk in front of a group of people, you're teaching online, or you're teaching in a classroom filled with live in-person interactions. Now, I'm going to share with you three laws of learning. And laws of learning are, for Mockingbird, they are universally accepted concepts in cognition or in cognitive learning design. Everything that Mockingbird does, we approach that from a cognitive perspective. My background is in cognition, which is the science of how we think and how we learn. And so all of our strategies that we use and that we promote and teach teachers are really grounded in those elements of how does the brain learn. And there's some fundamentals that are really important to share and to know and understand regardless of what your role may be. If you're interacting with students in any capacity, we consider these really valuable tools. So they're called the laws of learning. Go ahead and write LOL in your chat box. That stands for laws of learning, not laugh out loud. There you go. Laws of learning. And here's the very first one. And the very first one, and I have this little stick strategy right here, is to say this one out loud with me. It sounds like this. Attention is the mousetrap of learning. Now, I don't know where you're at right now on this presentation, but go ahead and say that out loud. Attention is the mousetrap of learning. And I'm asking you to say it out loud because if you say it out loud, it tags it more closely into memory, which is one of the challenges that we have when we're teaching online is that so much of it happens internally. And we want to encourage our learners to say those words out loud. So let me say this again. Attention is the mousetrap of learning. Just say it out loud. Here's what it means. No attention, no comprehension. Now, at the end of the day, part of what we do in teaching is that we want learners to literally remember that information when they walk away from a learning session. And attention determines what we process and therefore what we encode in memory. It's the mousetrap. I'll give you a picture to help orient us to this information. I'll give you a moment to look at this picture. I'll give you a moment to discover this picture. This will provide proof for attention is the mousetrap of learning. And let me very, very quickly describe this memory process for you. When you are learning, in the process of learning, you take in information from your senses. That information goes through the brain into a very specific portion of the brain called the reticular activating system. And that is where attention does its filtering work. And if attention doesn't filter that information and consider it a priority, then it's discarded. Information that is prioritized and that the brain has said, yes, this is important, I'm going to pay attention to this, goes into work and memory. And in a relationship between work and memory and long-term memory, we process, comprehend, and then encode that information. If it doesn't go through our attention filters, it never gets to the processing stage. So much time as teachers and instructors is spent thinking about long-term memory, testing learners for long-term memory. And Mockingbird would argue that if we spent that same amount of time focused on attention, we would actually get a lot better results in the classroom. So law number one is this. Attention is the mousetrap to learning. And attention, by all purposes, is really about engagement. Go ahead and write an E in your chat box for engagement. Yes, thank you. Thank you for participating. Now let's look at... Here we go, law of learning number two. Law of learning number two is this. We can only pay focused attention for a limited amount of time. It's the law of limited attention. And here's what that law means. It means that we can sustain attention for about our age in minutes up to about 20 minutes. That's our good rule of thumb or a common estimate. So here's what that means. We can sustain attention for about our age in minutes. Say this with me out loud. Say limited attention. Here's what that means. That means that a 3-year-old, an 8-year-old, and a 15-year-old can pay attention to about their age in minutes, but it has a peak to it. And that peak is about 20 to 21, which means my boyfriend, Matthew McConaughey, I'm a Texas girl, this is my Texas boyfriend, he stalks me, see how he's looking at me right now? He stalks me, he's 50 years old, and by this law, it would indicate that Matthew McConaughey could potentially pay attention to me for 50 minutes, but the reality is that the law has a peak to it, and that peak is about 20 to 21 minutes. So Matthew McConaughey cannot pay focused attention to his girlfriend, Tamara Thompson, for 50 minutes. Peaks, attention peaks at about 20 to 21 minutes. That's our common estimate. Here's that curve. It peaks about right here. Now think about the implications of this for just a second. Think about how in a typical lesson, what we have is attention spans that rise and fall over that period of time. Think about the implications of having lessons that were shorter in time frame that embrace our natural attention span. That's some of the work that Mockingbird Education does with learners and with programs. Now, I'm going to deliver some bad news. Yeah, Emma, exactly. Bad news. Here's the bad news. That's the attention span in a typical classroom. That doesn't even take into effect the idea if you're working with at-risk learners, which you may be. That's going to lower that attention rate. My personal anecdotal stories are about 15 minutes is what I'd say when you're working with an at-risk learner. What does that mean in the online environment? Let me ask that question. How long do you think you can pay sustained focused attention? What is my attention span in an online learning environment? Go ahead and give me a number in terms of minutes. How long do you think we can pay focused sustained attention? Yeah, there you go. Some of you are being incredibly generous. Here's the reality. It's about 2 to 3 minutes. Here's what happens. In about 2 to 3 minutes, there's a natural tendency for our brain to go, oh, I want to go check out those funniest cat videos, right? In about 2 to 3 minutes. Now, you and I may be as professionals, there's all kinds of ways we can manipulate that, and as professionals, you and I may stay engaged past that. But in an online environment, you got about 2 to 3 minutes, and then something has to happen. Go ahead and put a question mark in your chat box, because that means something has got to happen, and the question is, what? Now, that's law number two. Law number one is that attention is the mousetrap of learning. Law number two is that attention is limited. Now, let's look at law number three. And say this one out loud with me. Attention is cyclic. Say that out loud. Attention is cyclic. And here's what that means. It means that attention cycles through periods of engagement and diffusion. That's just a natural process that our brain goes through. We have these lapses, if you will, attention lapses throughout learning, and they're natural. It's a natural tendency for us to have high attention and then for it to start to diffuse, and for us to have high attention and it to start to diffuse. Now, the challenge in that is that when you have 15, or in this case, we may have 85 learners in this room, everybody's attention is on a different cycle. Go ahead and write DC in your chat box for different cycle. And our job is, okay, well, what are the strategies that help us coordinate those rises and falls together? So there's three universally accepted laws that I want to share with you. Attention is the mousetrap of learning. Limited attention is about 15, 20 minutes. And then attention is cyclic, which means that you have to capture attention. Now, you'll have questions, and I want to answer those questions. But before we answer those questions, I want to stop right here for just a second and do what I call a flash review. Go ahead and write FR in your chat box for flash review. And a flash review is simply this. It's a very, very quick re-emphasis of that information. I'm going to repeat these to you, and then I'm going to ask you to think about them and then articulate them in your own words, because you don't own information until you can put it in your own words. Attention is the mousetrap of learning, meaning that if we don't capture attention, we don't get comprehension. Attention is limited, meaning that we have to think about what happens about every 15 to 20 minutes. And attention is cyclic, meaning that we have to think about how we're going to recapture attention when it naturally diffuses. Now, I want to give you a moment to think about that. It's new information to you. You have two choices on how you can put that information back in your own words. You can either give me that in a chat box, or I want to give you another option, which is to write it down on a piece of paper. I'm going to ask you to put this in your own words. And if you write it down on a piece of paper and you have your phone nearby, just go ahead and click a picture of what you wrote and send it to this, text it rather, to that email address. That will give you a moment to think about the information that we're talking about. Now, as you do that, I'm going to stop here so that I can answer some questions. In the breakout session, we're going to talk about strategies that address these factors. But right now, I'll stop, give you a moment to put that in your own words, and then I'll gladly answer some questions about those laws to begin with. I'll pause there for just a second so our facilitators can facilitate if they would like.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Tamara. So it would be interesting to see those pictures too in the breakout session, if people have emailed pictures of text to you. So everyone, please do respond to that. I haven't seen any questions in the chat. Partially because one of the things that drew me to your webinar was your creative use of chat. And you've done you did exactly what I was hoping you would do, is to demonstrate how you can use chat to sort of reset that attention, but through an activity, through some sort of action.